5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Jesus Christ, you better... Sheriff, Gia!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. You know, it's interesting, I got a phone call last night. Actually started out with an email, but I spoke with a police officer in Texas, and he was getting called out to this prowler call on these people's property. And what's interesting, when I spoke with him, he just started listening to the show. He flat out told me that he didn't know if Sasquatch was real or not. He's never seen one, but it's a topic that's always fascinated him. But he was telling me about this prowler call he was getting called out to these people's property. And their house backs up to the National Forest. The police officer said the first time he was called out to the property was about 11 o'clock at night, and the witness had reported seeing three large black males around his property, moving stuff around his property. When he had called the police, he was looking out the window. They made eye contact. The three black males, as a witness reports, ran back into the wood line. And in his mind, he thought these were homeless guys. He thought these were people messing with his property. Cop went out there. Nothing was really taken. There was nothing really to report. The cop gets called back out there a week later. It's about 2 o'clock in the morning. And the person who called the police stated that, the homeless guys, three black men were back. They were throwing rocks at his house. He either thought they were throwing rocks at his house or, slapping the side of his house. Cop goes out there. He doesn't really see any damage. He just doesn't, you know, they're not there. There's nothing. He tells the homeowner, hey, I'll be in the area. If they return, call me. They kind of searched the property around, couldn't find any evidence of any people out there messing with this guy's property. And the guy told the officer something interesting. He said, you know, I'm really getting sick of this. I think these are homeless guys living out in the forest behind my home. He goes, I hear them all hours of the night out there screaming, yelling, chopping down trees. And the officer had asked the witness, what do you mean chopping down trees? He goes, well, you hear chopping and then you hear trees falling over. He goes, I think they're out there chopping. He goes, I think they're living out there. When I spoke with the police officer, he said he was perplexed by it because A, they don't really have a whole lot of African Americans out in this particular county. In Texas, and B, he's never heard of a prowler call where the prowler is trying to make as much noise as possible. So he said he's kind of perplexed by it. It doesn't really make sense to him what's going on this property. There's nothing ever really gets taken. Nothing ever really gets damaged. Even when the witness had reported either the house being slapped or rocks being thrown at the house, there was no damage to the house. And so the cop's kind of perplexed. He's been out there several times. When I spoke with him, he asked me what my opinion of it was. And I told him, I said, you know what? it sounds like Sasquatch activity to me. It sounds like they have a couple Sasquatches out there. It's an older home. They recently moved into it. It backs up to the National Forest. All the behavior sounds like Sasquatch activity. I don't think it's quote-unquote three black guys out there messing with this guy's property. But if you don't believe in Sasquatch, what else could it be? I'll tell you what, I'm going to use a lifeline here. I'm going to phone a friend. I'm going to call Tim Sermons, our buddy down there in Texas. Tim, I'm on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? I know you've already heard the question. The responses are A, Sasquatch, B, Sasquatch, C, Sasquatch, or D, three black men causing trouble on this farm. Your answer, please.
D, Sasquatch, final answer.
Thanks, man. Tim Sermons, everyone. Well, there you go, folks. You know, if you don't believe in Sasquatch, I guess you could chalk it up to homeless people or vagrants or, whatever you want to chalk it up to. I really think that this guy has activity going on his property, but I get it. If Sasquatch isn't the soup you swim in, it's easy to pass it off as something else. Everything sounds like Sasquatch behavior, though. I'll give you updates as soon as I have them. My first guest tonight is Dan, and Dan's actually from Canada. His father was a tracker, taught him how to track. He worked a lot in the forest. Dan, welcome to the show.
Oh, no, thank you. I appreciate the time, for sure.
And I know you wanted to give a shout-out, so I'll let you go ahead and do your shout-out.
I just wanted to see if there's anyone in Alberta who's seen anything or anything like that would like to get in touch with me. I'm always interested in getting out in the field. So if you're in southern Alberta or eastern British Columbia, for sure you can get an email at dcronald@hotmail.com and just let me know if you want to get out in the field. I'm always interested in just checking things out, for sure.
Yeah, so definitely, hopefully people in your area will contact you. The first time you found tracks, and I want to get into your second encounter, which is a little bit more extensive than your first, but it's probably important to tell this first encounter. You were actually, well, tell the audience, what were you doing at the time, and what did you see as far as tracks?
My dad's a park ranger up in Alberta here. I was born in Banff National Park, and I grew up in the provincial park system my whole life. Lived out in the wilderness. I'm an avid hunter, fisher, just because of being in contact with my dad. He's a trained rescue tracker who goes out on rescues and does pursuit tracking. And they sort of like have their own organization where they go and all get together with law enforcement officials, border patrol individuals, and anyone else who's into like the tracking world. And they have their little seminars and stuff like that and train. So I'm secondhand exposed to a lot of information on tracking. And, because I'm an avid hunter, I'm out there and I'm practicing. And it's one of those things that, I pride myself on as far as the skill set,
You have a background in tracking. You have a background, your dad, from your dad. So when you've seen a bear track, when you've seen a cougar track, when you've seen the animals, the known animals out there, what you're looking at when you see these.
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, I've hunted all my whole life basically. And I can tell you exactly what track is and just based on experience, a lot of times, I can tell you, what they're doing and things like that. You know what I mean? The first experience I had would have been in 2004. I was up, we were tree planting, I was in college there. My, first summer break in college, I got a job, tree planting up in northern British Columbia. And we had a big contract up, north of Fort St. John towards the Pink Mountain area. I guess it would be all east of that, from east of the Alaska Highway towards the Alberta border. So I don't know if any of your listeners are aware of the area, but I mean, it's basically there's really nothing up there besides oil and gas, logging, you know, infrastructure. We were on a tele contract. So basically we drove down a access road off of the Alaska Highway. I think we were 80 or so kilometers in off that point, and then we drove to our staging point where the helicopters meet us, and they fly us out. It was probably only like a 15-minute flight to the drop point, and then they drop us off. There's trees already organized there, and then you basically bag up. By that, I mean, you just take the, you have like cheap lining sacks on your hips, and you load them up with, we load up with about 300 to 500 trees, depending on what we're planting. And then you head up, and we're doing high-angle plants. So we basically like bagged up in the morning after I got dropped off from the helicopter and walked up. And it was just kind of like it's one of those cut blocks that kind of was a little bit eerie, just because we had found a moose kill on that cut block. And it was just covered in berries. We often have times, you know, like where we encounter grizzlies quite often while we're up there working. So you're always kind of on guard and looking around. But I bagged up and did my first line. So usually you plant along the tree line and then fill back down towards your supply of trees, you know what I mean? So that you're not like having to cross over areas that you planted. So I planted up the tree line, and first thing, you know, nature called. And we're always planting in pairs just for safety. And so I told my partner, you know, you go on ahead. I found like a nice little spot just kind of in a bench that was on our piece. So I tucked in on this little bench, and it was kind of a really neat spot because you could overlook like the whole valley and just the huge area around us. Tucked in there and kind of found a little spot where I could do my business. And just as I was getting set, I looked down and I noticed there was like a trail through the grass, just impressions more than anything. There was a black anthill where they pull up the really fine soil, and there was one track just stomped in it. As a kid growing up in the bush, I've done that thousands of times where you just thumped an anthill and watched them run around, and it was a track. Like, I have a size 9 foot, and it was right around the same size as my foot, but it was like, I don't know, I was kind of call it like a block foot. Like, it was as wide as it was long. It was a barefoot human track on a cup lock that we flew into. Like, there's just no one out there.
What did you think when you saw it?
The first thing I honestly thought was, you know, like, oh my God, who was just here? You know what I mean? Like, I kind of first like thought someone was maybe playing a joke on me, you know what I mean? But we just flew in. We were lucky enough to be the first group to fly in, because you kind of like, you get paid by the tree, so you want to be first in, last out to make your money. So, I mean, yeah, I honestly thought someone was like playing a joke on me. And then I kind of just started looking at the track, because it was just one of those perfect imprints. It was, you know, the perfect soil conditions, just for immaculate detail. You could see, I guess, the dermal ridges, just that they came like down the side of the foot and kind of like ran parallel to the side of the foot. And it was just, you know what I mean? Like, it was strange. And my dad's a park ranger, and he actually wrote a paper when he was in forestry school on Sasquatch, and he had a couple books from that sitting around. So I had read those when I was a kid and was exposed to the idea of Sasquatch. But I mean, in my whole life, I had never encountered anything like that. And as soon as I saw it, it just didn't make sense more than anything else. It didn't look human because it was so wide, and it was just in a location that was, you know, indescribable for someone to be walking barefoot. Like, you wouldn't walk across a cup block in bare feet.
You and I talked about the track earlier. It's like what I was telling you earlier. You know, I've seen that track personally, physically seen that track before, or that type of track before, And I've seen casts of that type of track before. But when you see it, when you're out walking around and you see it, you automatically think like, I think I described it to you as like Fred Flintstone's foot.
Yeah, like a block foot. And you know what? It was funny because it was just like, it was just one of those things where like, you know, as a kid, I'd done it hundreds of times and I knew exactly what had happened there. You know what I mean? Like that, it was so fresh that the ants were still running around on it. They hadn't repaired it even, you know, like a little bit. So it really put me on edge because I knew whatever had made that track had just left the scene. And then I could see just the impressions in the grass. It wasn't like any screaming, you know, Sasquatch evidence other than this completely out of place track. You know what I mean?
Did you ever show the track to your partner?
Yeah, actually, I pulled him over and I was like, "You man, you got to look at this." And he was like, "Yeah, there's a track." And I was like, "Yeah, no." Like, and then I was like, "What is a barefoot human doing out here?" And he was like, "Oh my God!" Like, and we actually went down to our we call them caches where we keep our bags and stuff like that. And we were trying to get a camera to take a photo of it. Like, it was before, you know, I had a good digital camera or anything like that. And we had forgotten our camera at the truck. So, you know, we try to tell people like, "Oh my God, we've seen a Sasquatch track." And that was just like, you know, the first time I really experienced like that. Sure you did. You know what I mean? Like, just no, even my cat was like, "It was a bear track." I'm like, "You don't understand. It wasn't anything other than, it wasn't a human track." I'll just say that. You know what I mean?
But you got blowback from talking about it. Do you want to fast?
Yeah, people made fun of me.
Yeah, and that's generally what happens. Do you want to fast forward to when you found those sets of tracks again and you were fishing? Kind of walk the audience into what happened.
Okay. So I guess it'd be fast forward to like 8 years, you know what I mean? And I'd been like, after seeing that track, I was absolutely fascinated by the idea of Sasquatch and doing tons of research, you know what I mean? And I even, like, I told my wife, you know, like, "I've seen the tracks. I know they're out there." And I told my dad, they're like, you know, they're like, "Sure you did." I'm like, "No, you don't understand. I know they're out there." So fast forward again, like I said, I was up kind of similar area, south of Pink Mountain on the east side of that Alaska Highway, again, back towards Alberta. I work now for oil and gas company, doing directional drilling. So, I mean, I kind of like seek out jobs where I can get out in the bush, and I really enjoy, you know, just after growing up there my whole life. We were coming into a drilling rig, and I don't, like, the roads are basically just go trails, you know what I mean, up to these drill sites. And I always bring all my fishing gear along with me. You know, oftentimes, whenever I can, I you know, bring my hunting gear and stuff. But it was midsummer, so I just brought all my fly fishing stuff, and was just kind of looking for a spot to go. And on the way into the rig, we came across like a really nice little like stream. There was, you know, lots of little meandering spots, beaver ponds, and then there was a real steep incline, and it was like real death trap of a bridge, like a steep bridge, one lane bridge, going up the hill. And as you looked over to the left hand side, so that would be probably north, I just looked over and there was like a really nice fishing hole that was down there. You could see where the river was, you know, paralleling the road, and then hit a really like the steep bank that we were driving up, and then made like a right angle. And there was a deep, you know, swirling pool that you could see from the road. And my buddy, you know, we have the two-way radios all the time, and he's like, there's your fishing hole, bud. And I'm like, you know it is. So took a couple days to actually like get all set up. And I'd gone out the day before on a spot on that same stream that was closer to the rig we were on. But I'd you know, come across that day alone, like a set of bear tracks that was from at least, you know, 1,000-pound grid. Like the width of the track was, I'd say around, you know, 7 to 8 inches. You know what I mean? Like you put your hand in it and it doesn't cover even the pad of the grizzly track. You know what I mean? And then, I don't know, I sent you some photos from some of the game that had been taken out of that area. Like it's monster country. Like I came across a set of wolf tracks, you know what I mean? Like a pack of wolves that had gone through the river, you know, 8-9 individuals. You can see the alpha track is well over 200 pounds. So when you're out fly fishing there, you don't just zone out and throw your earbuds in and let it roll. So I was parked on the uphill side of the bridge, which I guess would have been kind of like a funny spot to park, and had walked downhill and then under the bridge on the downstream side. Just kind of looking back at it, I think that's probably the only reason I ever seen anything is because most people would have driven down the bridge, parked on the downhill side. It's only a one-lane bridge. There's turnoffs on both sides. Most people would have just parked on the downhill side and walked in. There was a pretty well-beaten path down there, even with a quad path, you know what I mean? And because it's one of the only places you could cross that stream. It's not like, we're, you know what I mean, there's no one up there. There's people up there, hunters and stuff like that, and oil and gas workers. So I parked there, walked around, and was kind of like tied on a fly under the bridge. And was just, we're fishing for Arctic grayling, so I just tied on, gave a few casts, and there was like a little bit of a log break just under the bridge. I casted out there and like hooked up into some roots and snapped my fly off like pretty much immediately. So I was like, ah, I'll just walk up to this fishing hole. Like you could see it was a deep hole. And I'd say to you earlier, it was probably like under 200 yards, but when I was thinking about it, it was probably like 150, maybe 120 yards from the bridge to the hole. Just sort of reeled in and started walking up towards the hole, you know, just kind of getting a feel for the area and scouting it out. And as I was walking upstream, there's two ducks. Well, they're like fishing ducks. They're common Nagansers, the red-headed ones. They eat a lot of fish, and usually when you see them, it's a good sign that there's some in the hole. So they flushed up off the hole and flew downstream towards me, and it was just enough to give me that, like, wonder what pushed those up. And I was just kind of like looking up at the hole and just, you know, just being aware of what was around. And just on the other side of the stream, across the stream, the sun was actually shining like kind of downstream at me, and I just seen a huge brown movement cut across a gap in the trees, just whoop. And I immediately thought grizzly, because when you're out there, you're looking for grizzly, you know what I mean?
I would imagine in that part of the country, you really have to be careful and be on alert for grizzlies, because it's not like dealing with a black bear.
Yeah, there's grizzly, cougar, and you know what I mean? Like, all, like, I don't know, I sent you a couple of pictures of the predators that were taken out of there. It's enough to make most people stay out of the woods. I was kind of on guard already, and then there was the ducks came flushing up downstream towards me, which is just another thing. Like, usually they'll fly away from you, and they flushed up, flew downstream, and I was like, and then boom, just huge movement cut between two trees, and it was kind of silhouetted, you know what I mean? And I thought grizzly, you know what I mean? But, you know, I fish with my gun and a can of pepper spray pretty well everywhere I go, you know what I mean? And so I pull out the gun and I pull out my pepper spray, and I was just kind of like looking towards the spot. And as I looked upstream, I could see a set of tracks that had come out of the bush down to the stream and then upstream from me. They were big enough that I could see them from, you know, several yards away. I'd have been about, you know, 50 yards away, but still like big tracks. And it just, like, it was one of those things where you, like, you see something, you think it's something, and then I just kind of like thought, that's not right, you know what I mean? Like, I was like, it didn't seem like a bear. So I continued walking forward. I just wanted to check the scene out, and I didn't want to go home and not fish, or back to the rig and not fish. So I kind of went up towards the scene, and I was walking in, and I could see just massive barefoot human tracks that came out of there was like a strip of spruce trees. So there's the river, like a little pebble beach, and some sand and stuff like that, and a strip of spruce trees that were about 5-6 feet wide, and then like a little clearing on the other side. So whatever it was in the trees, had spotted me or heard me and came out and looked from the only spot on the river where you could see where I was standing when I was under the bridge, and then walked upstream. And as I got closer, I just looked, and they were like, I don't know, it would have to be Shaquille O'Neal that made the tracks, you know what I mean? They were like perfectly flat foot track, like sneaking, like flat foot. And there was one where I sent you a photo of it, and it was like he had set his foot down right beside the stick, you know what I mean? There was a stick on the beach, and he set his foot down avoidantly, you know what I mean? Like, changed the course of his foot, set it down, and it was like right beside the stick, and walked off, you know, flat-footed. And I just kind of wanted to know, like, at that point, like, had I seen a Sasquatch, you know, and basically, I'm looking at it, and there's one of the tracks that you could see, there was a double dimple in the middle of the foot, where it doesn't have like an arch. It has a double dimple in the middle of the foot where the foot bent over, and you could see there's just the toe splay on it is huge, like the big toe, the size of an egg, and then it comes off at like, you know, an angle from the foot, and then the rest of the toes were like gripping into the mud, you know what I mean? Like splayed out.
So kind of like, would you say kind of like a gorilla's foot?
No, not anything like that, but like, I don't know if you've ever seen like the tracks of someone that's ever worn shoes, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know how else to explain it. Like, your toes are like splay out. They were like normal sized, I don't have to describe it without a photo or anything like that, but.
Almost like it was grabbing with the toes is what you're saying.
Yeah, your toes are able to like spread out and grip into the ground. You know what I mean, like I've seen it like on guys, and when I went to the Amazon, like the locals, like they've never worn shoes, and their feet, like they set their feet down and their toes like grab the ground in front of them because they've never worn shoes. You know what I mean? You're just, it develops a different type of foot, I guess. I don't know. You know what I mean? But it was strange enough to where it didn't look human. And there's the physiology of the track with that double dimple. You know what I mean? Like a human foot doesn't have that morphology. Like you can't bend your foot in the middle of your foot. Like it was like, say where your ankle is, about, you know, halfway between the ankle and the toe. There's another bend in that foot that leaves an impression in the center of the track.
Oh, I gotcha.
I've heard like a lot of the other, like, you know, stuff on Sasquatch, guys call it the mid-torsal break.
Right.
So just seeing that, like, it just made the hair stand up on the back of my neck, you know what I mean? Like, and knowing that I'd seen it right after it flushed those ducks, and I could see this on the other side of the river where there was only like one really dense stand of spruce trees, and the rest was a big slope, you know what I mean? Like where the bridge was cut into, and then there's a flat, like a river valley area, flats on the, like, where the river flats butt into a slope, and there's a big stand of spruce trees right of the, I guess it would be the sheltered side of the hill, you know what I mean? So I just, you know, immediately just super curious, because, you know, what actually came across my mind was like, aha, I told you so. So all the, you know what I mean? Like all the people that have made fun of me and my wife and everything. This is like, sort of like, aha, I knew it. And then I just sort of needed to know like what I'd seen. So I started tracking it up the beach. And I came to where it crossed the stream. And, it's not like a big stream, you know what I mean? The river itself is, like there's little rapids above the fishing hole, and it was only probably, I don't know, under 20 feet across, you know what I mean? So I just tracked it up to that point, and it was walking within a normal gait. I just sort of, I crossed across the stream, and it went from a normal gait in the spot where it was sneaking away from me to like right where it would have flushed those ducks up, and it it went from I paced it the way I measured it, was as far as I could possibly step, like stretched out, and it did one out of the water, one step like that, like flat footed to another step on like a rock, wash rock beach, like those, you know, boulders the size of baseballs and like all kind of rounded river rock. And then from there, it stepped, like it covered like over 6 feet span, and it stepped up onto the bank about 3 feet, and it did it from a flat footed track. And these were just wet foot impressions on the stones to a wet foot impression on the bank. So it went and covered 20 feet in a matter of strides, and just and up onto the bank too. And at that point, I don't know what it was, like my body wouldn't allow me to go any further, you know what I mean? I just kind of froze. I turned back around and I came back to the spot where, like on the other side of that deep hole, I was just kind of like looking into the spruce trees where I had gone down the trail. There was like a good game trail that ran right along that hole. And I was looking into that set of trees, and you know, I have my gun up, my pepper spray in my other hand, and just on high alert, like just scanning for any movement, any sort of tell, because I knew it was there. I knew I'd just seen it. I knew it had gone that direction. I knew where it was. And I was looking, and there's just nothing, no movement. And it was just dead quiet, and all of a sudden it whistled like a chickadee. Just like this. I kind of was like, oh my God, because it sounded off, like deep. Like it was way deeper than a chickadee. It was like a big guy trying to impersonate a chickadee. And the first thing, you know what I mean, that like struck my mind was, it's whistling at me. So I actually like whistled back to it with the same call. And even just like halfway through what I was doing, my mind just like switched, because as a hunter, that's one of the things I do, especially when I have like a close group of friends that I hunt with, my brother especially. And you know, when you see something in the woods, and you want to get your partner's attention, you don't go like, "Hey,"
right? You whistle to him.
Yeah, like what we use is like the same thing. A chickadee whistle too is what really freaked me out. It's like we always do the cheeseburger call, like just to get your buddy's attention. And then I just like right at that point, I just thought like, "Oh my God, he's not whistling to me." And I had this vision of like, you know, a basketball sized rock like gumming me in the back of the head, and I just turned and lit out, man. Like I was gone. Ran and sprinted as fast as I could. I was, you know, I was armed and sitting there, but literally it felt like I was carrying like a pea shooter.
Mike Woolley talked about his encounter, and it's kind of like a little bit like yours, except for I think they were a little bit closer and his was a little bit more up close and personal. But one of the things he said in his encounter was it turned and whistled, and kind of like the whistle you just did. And he didn't realize what it was doing at first until another one showed up. Another one came right to where this thing had whistled or called for it. And, you know, it makes you wonder. We do the exact same thing. You're right. A lot of hunters do that. They'll whistle so you don't scare the game away. It makes you wonder if you were game that day.
Yeah, like the thing is like that that river crossing there, it runs along the you know what I mean, like a good incline, and it's really the only place that you can cross that I'd say creek easily, because the rest of it's got like it's kind of like one of those muskeg creeks. It's keyed out, and it's got like a lot of deep holes and slow moving areas, lots of decomposing plant matter. You know what I mean? It's tough to get through, anyways. But there's like a really, really hard packed trail that crosses at the rapids just above that spot. And there's game like you wouldn't believe, like elk, moose, deer sign. And then there's also wild horses right in that area that we've seen earlier. So in my mind, it was sitting right along the trail at a major choke point. And also, it was like a lookout, because anyone that had probably come up to that spot previously and parked in the lower pullout zone and walked along that game trail right up to that cross, right where the deep hole is. And, you know what I mean? It was like a perfect lookout spot.
Yeah, it was a perfect ambush spot. A lot of hunters will choose areas like that, you know, where the deer and the animal, they all funneled into this. It sounds like a perfect funnel where prey funnels into an area. And I know a lot of hunters look for that.
Yeah, it was a little choke point right where there's tons of game come along there. I mean, the rivers draw all the game. They need water. It provides lots of food and all this other stuff. You know what I mean? It was parked in a spot where it could easily, I don't know, if you were working together, one on either side of that river, you know, there's nothing getting by you on that trail, guaranteed, you know what I mean?
It's an interesting take from someone who's out there all the time, someone who's a known, you know, you're a tracker, to see something like that. You know, like I said, isn't your first day in the woods. It's not, you know, you're not a city guy coming in and might mistake something for something else.
No. Yeah, and I'm not one of those guys, like you said, I've seen a lot of things out there, and I'm not one of those guys that's like, everything's Sasquatch, you know what I mean? I've spent a lot of time in the woods. I live out there, you know, I do solo 5-day trips all the time, prospecting and hunting and scouting, so.
Well, I can't thank you enough for being on the show. And do you want to give your email address one more time for people?
Yeah, for sure. Anyone who's in the Alberta or I guess Eastern BC area, if you want to contact me at ecronald@hotmail.com, you feel free. And would love to get out in the field and just check out a few spots.
Well, I appreciate it, Dan.
Yeah.
Thank you again for being.
I appreciate you having the honor. I was, you know, a big fan, and you can give me a call anytime for sure.
Yeah, thank you again for being on, man.
Right on. Take care. Thanks a lot.
My next guest is Chance. And Chance actually had a couple encounters. One was in Oklahoma, and the other one was in Arkansas. And he describes an encounter he had as a child, and then one many years later, where him and a friend of his actually shot one. Chance, welcome to the show. I appreciate you being here tonight.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
Your first encounter happened in Oklahoma. Can you walk us through? Tell us what you're doing. Tell us what you saw. Just kind of walk us into the whole encounter, if you would.
Well, what I was doing was I was really just a kid. Me and a friend had a friend staying over for basically the whole summer. And we were, 8 or 9 years old, and we were just out messing around, catching fireflies and stuff. And not on the outskirts of town, but, you know, in town, but right beside of me, there was an empty field, 300 acres out there probably with nothing on it. And there's a creek that went through there. And me and him would go out in this field at night and catch fireflies and stuff. And we had these little cheap flashlights because, you know, we were kids. And we went out there one evening to catch the fireflies. It was probably 8:30 from 9 o'clock at night, somewhere around there. It was probably 1984, 85. And we were walking around out through there, and we seen something that was unusual because it was in the field and couldn't get a good look at it. So we kept getting closer and closer. And by the time our little lights finally did illuminate it, it was just standing in the middle of this field. It was almost completely gray with, looked like maybe red mud or something mixed in with it, like it maybe been in a creek. But it didn't look dirty or anything like that. But it was standing kind of quartered away from us, and it was just kind of looking back at us. I mean, it was completely aware of us. And that was the first thing that came to both of our minds, you know, was it was Bigfoot, you know, but of course, you know, at the time, you know, Bigfoot was only in California, and there was only one or two. So it couldn't be Bigfoot. So we were sitting there trying to think of what this thing was. And like I said, the flashlights we had were just horrendous. As we were trying to get a better look at this thing, light went out. And by the time we rattled it back on, it was pretty much almost completely out of our sight. It probably moved 50 or 60 yards to the wood line. And had its back to us, and that's the last glimpse we got of it. We did go ahead and walk down that way, but not very far before we thought better of it and went ahead and went back home.
When it walked away, did it walk away on two legs the whole time?
Yeah, it was definitely on two legs the whole time. Yeah, there was no doubt about it. I mean, when we got a good glimpse of it, I mean, we were standing within 30 feet of this thing. we, like I said, we were just kids, but definitely got a good look at it. I mean, there was no mistaking what this thing was. I mean, it almost looked like a messed up gorilla, but it was gray and really big. I mean, it was just unbelievable the size of this thing. I mean, it wasn't overly tall. It was just overly big in every single way.
Do you remember any features of it, or was it, is it mainly the...
Yeah, mostly really the face is what I remember the most, because like I said, the little eyes we had were really bad, but the way it was turned back, looking at us, you could, the face was mostly didn't have any hair on it. I mean, it was about almost like a man with a beard, but the beard was, you know, real scraggly looking. It wasn't, you know, a solid full beard. And the hairline started out almost at the eye, had a big ridge for eyebrows. You know, it had a big ridge right above its eyes, and its hair, it basically started almost there and started going back. Had a definite cone-shaped head. You know, its forehead was definitely slanting back. Like I said, it was gray, and I mean, its eyes, solid brown eyes, just almost like a shark's eyes that are solid black, but these were solid brown.
Yeah, that's interesting. What, do you remember anything? Were the arms longer? Were they in proportion?
About the only time I really ever seen most of his arms was whenever he was walking away, and they did seem like they were actually a little bit too long for his body. Like, whenever he was walking, it seemed like I said, I didn't see him take a long walk, maybe 3 or 4 steps, and he seemed like his knees, his hands were actually below his knees.
Yeah, and so it kind of had the impression like you're looking at a weird-looking gorilla, or...
Yeah, and it seemed like it wasn't, in the way it walked, too, it was not like it was walking straight upright like a man. I mean, it wasn't hunched over either, but the way that it walked, it walked kind of like it was a squat. You know what I mean? It was it wasn't like a completely up tall, you know, just strolling. It was kind of squatted down.
Yeah.
If that makes any sense.
No, it makes complete sense, actually. They do have a weird gait, especially when they're walking off. Did you tell anyone about this encounter afterwards?
You know, at the time we didn't even consider telling anyone, to tell you the truth. You know, me and him both just kind of put it off to, well, it was just something, you know, something weird we seen, you know, because we didn't know what it was. You know, and at the time, you know, I'm sure if we'd have known what it was, you know, absolutely, we would have told someone. But at the time, you know, we really didn't know what it was, so we just chalked it up to nothing. A few years later, we did go down there and find prints down there on that creek. In fact, it wasn't me and that friend. It was me and my cousin actually went down there and scared him to death. In fact, he tore the tracks up and left because he was afraid. He lived down there by it.
What did the tracks look like?
The main one we found, it looked like something barefoot. It was definitely barefoot. Had came up out of the creek, and the bank was it was a clay bank. It was probably 6 or 7 feet tall, and you could tell where it looked like this thing had stuck a foot, maybe halfway up the bank, 3 or 4 foot up on the bank, and then put a hand down on top of the bank, and I guess I'm assuming lifted himself up, because that's all there was. It was a track of a foot, 1 foot, and a handprint on top, the very top of the bank. Like he'd put a hand and a foot down and then just lifted himself up onto the bank. And that once you got up on top of the bank, it was dry and it wouldn't leave any prints or anything. But that's the only things we saw. And that was probably 4 or 5 years later.
And then you had a second encounter, didn't you? Will you tell us about that?
Yeah, second encounter was just kind of came out of nowhere. Me and a friend of mine, we were out here, we're up in Arkansas, actually not too far from east of Fort Smith, 30 miles down the Ozark Forest. We were out there pretty much road hunting at night. He was in the back of the truck, and I was in the front of the truck driving with a spotlight, and we're creeping along a little country road. Some deer bust out of the brush in front of us about, a couple hundred yards in front of us, you know, bust out the brush, and there's a creek right on the other side of this road, and deer run across this road, and usually when they hit that creek, they'll freak out, turn back around, and run back across the road. Well, these didn't. They just ran right across the road, act like they were running or something. And they went right across the road. And we hadn't really seen anything that night, you know, just a few animals here and there. And we And once those deer crossed the road, we decided, well, we'll just pull up there, see if there's any more out there in the field where they just came from. So we pulled up there and stopped and started hitting that field with the spotlight. And sure enough, not maybe 50 yards, 60 yards off the road, there was something standing there. And a buddy of mine in the back with the gun, he said, I don't think that's a deer. I said, well, I really don't think it is either. I don't know what it would be. You know, we're out here, there's no one's property. There's no cattle or horses or, you know, anyone's pets or anything like that out there. I said, well, I don't know what it is either. I said, just go ahead and shoot it. He says, okay. So he takes a shot at this thing, and he was just a horible shot, and he was just shooting a little 22 anyway. They kill a deer with a 22, yeah, pretty much did in the eye or right in the head. Anyway, he shot this thing. It didn't flinch, didn't do anything, but maybe 5 or 6 seconds later, it started rocking back and forth. Just maybe it rocked 3 or 4 times, and that's when it started screaming at us. And it was just unbelievable. Like that buddy of mine that was actually there and actually shot this thing, he has it down really good, the sound, but of course I don't. But it was just absolutely unbelievable, the way this thing sounded. It was like cross between a screech owl and a wild cat caught in a trap or something. It was unbelievable, but really loud. The volume was what was unbelievable, just the sheer volume of the way this creature sounded. Then, of course, as soon as I looked back up behind me, and there was a truck coming down the road, so we had to shut the spotlight off and go, and this thing was still screaming at us. So we go ahead and leave, and we come back by after that. We got that truck out behind us and didn't see anything standing there before. So we went ahead and went home that evening. That next day we got up and we went back out there because, I mean, the spot's obvious. I mean, there's no mistaking where it was at. And we went out there to where he had shot this thing, and there was blood on the ground. But there was no animal anywhere around. But whatever it was had been standing in a ditch, and this ditch had to have been 4 or 5 feet tall, so whatever it was considerably taller than what we at first thought it was. Because at first we assumed it was about deer size, 4 feet, 4.5 feet there at the hedge, but once we got out there and seen it was actually standing in the ditch, this thing had to be at least 6 feet tall to be up to where it was.
And you guys never really got a good look at it, right?
No, now this thing we never really did get a good look at. Really didn't. Now, that's the reason I'm not saying it was definitely one, but I've seen bear. I've lived out here all my life. I've seen bear and bobcats and everything you can see out here I've seen. And that was definitely not something that was every day.
Yeah, most animals, especially after you shoot them, even if you can't take them down with a 22,
exactly.
They're not going to stick around and vocalize.
Yeah, what kind of animal, after you shoot it, is going to start, and I mean, it started coming towards us at this point. After he shot it, it started coming towards us, screaming. What animal does that? I've shot lots of animals off the road, and, I've never had anything act anywhere near as, creepy as that. It was really strange. It really put the fear into us.
That rocking back and forth, was it like a primate-type rocking back and forth? I don't know if you've ever seen YouTube videos of primates when they're nervous or when they're agitated or right before they blow up, they do this thing where they kind of rock back and forth.
Now, see, this thing, it seemed like it was, tell you the truth, I think when we shot it, it pissed it off. And, because I think when we hit it, you probably hit it in the head, but I don't think, it was just probably a glancing blow. I'm sure the bullet bounced right off the skull. But I think it pissed it off. Because that's one of it. Just as soon as we shot it, I mean, it wasn't like it, by no means was it I'm getting woozy from being shot rocking back and forth. I mean, this was a definite, here I come rocking back and forth. Like it was, because it was coming. I mean, it took several steps towards us. And, after he shot it. And, I don't know if I'd have stayed there much longer if the other truck hadn't showed up behind us or if I would have, took off anyway just out of fear. Because of the way this thing screaming, it was unbelievable. It was, if you ever went to a rock concert and sat too close to one of the speakers, it was something like that. It was unbelievable.
The whole part of that encounter, there's a couple things that are interesting, but one of the things interesting about the encounter is the fact that it was coming towards you guys. Thank God that truck came. Because if you all you had was that 22, if one didn't take it down, I don't think five or six are going to take it down. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and I don't think so either. Yeah, I mean, I think my only option would have been to take off in the truck. But, you know, I was definitely going to let it get closer because I'd like to see what it was. But you know, my buddy in my back, he was panicking. He was, you know, he's the one that shot. He was scared by then, telling me, go, 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 go. You know, and I'm in the truck saying, well, hold on, I'm going to see, you know, what this thing is, because it was coming. And there was no fence or anything. There was just a little tree line in between us and it. You know, I mean, it wasn't like a lot of brush or anything like that. It was really strange, though. It was almost like a, I don't want to really say that it's a hair or whatever was absorbing the light, but I'm hitting this thing with a 3 million candle power spotlight, and it's not no more than 75 or 80 yards away at first. You know, you can see around this thing, but it's just like whatever this thing was, all you could see was eyes and a dark silhouette. Even whenever it came closer, I mean, you could see tree limbs and stuff in front of this thing, but this thing, you could see nothing but eyes and a silhouette.
Yeah, we've had people in the past describe that. It has to do with, I think what we theorized was it has to do with the pigment of the skin. When the light hits it, it's all with the pigment of the skin to give it that appearance like this light soaking it up.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what it was. It was really odd. You know, the whole situation was just really, I've been out in the woods my whole life, coon hunting, whole nine yards, never even thought of being afraid out in the woods. And, you know, this thing made the hair on the back of my neck stand up just instantly when it started screaming. But it was almost like a roller coaster ride, you know, just real intense. Just here in the past, oh, I don't know, 3 months or so, I have had several other things kind of happen. But, you know, where we had my friend and I shot that one, it was about a mile from where I live. And I live out on 20 acres, you know, not real out in the country, but, you know, country enough. Just the other night, I was out walking the dog, and, you know, out here in country lane, you know, no lights, nothing. And I was just kind of mesmerized, just letting him drag me around. I had him on a leash. Something started screamed at me twice from the wood line, oh, I don't know, probably 150, 200 yards out. At first, I kind of thought it might have been a bull. But then I got to thinking that, you know, this old man that had the land next to me, he passed away several years ago, and they don't have cattle anymore. And that, by the time that hit me, I thought about that. It screamed again, and this time it didn't sound like a bull. I didn't hear it anymore. But then a couple of days later, I was out whistling for my dog to come in, of course, and something started whistling from out about in the middle of my field. My field's just a big overgrown mess. But something was mimicking me whistling.
Really?
Out in the middle of my field. Yeah, it was really odd. I mean, it was enough to, you know, it was definitely enough to make me wonder, you know, who the hell's out in the middle of my field at 1 o'clock at night.
You hear that all the time from witnesses when they have them around their property. Yeah, they mimic the whistle. Sometimes they people hear them mimic them calling for their dog. Some people, I've heard people mimic where a husband, where a wife, thought she heard her husband out in the forest calling for her.
Oh, geez.
Just real weird stuff like that. You hear it all the time with witnesses. How long ago did that encounter happen when you shot one?
A friend of mine learned that one. I want to say that was in probably 2011 or so. I was going to look today and see exactly what year it was because I've got pictures on Facebook and stuff of different things we had shot around the same time. And me and the same guy, so I know exactly what day it was, or not day, but at least exactly what year it was. But I think it was somewhere around 2011 or so. You know, I've had several strange, you know, I've seen panthers out here before too, you know, mountain lions, which we're not supposed to have. But, you know, and this whatever that was out there, I mean, I don't really know what it was. I mean, so I didn't get a good look at it. Like I said, it was, you know, you couldn't see the damn thing pretty much, but just the way it sounded, it was definitely not something normal, just for lack of a better word.
Yeah, and you've heard mountain lion, I mean, you've heard cougar,
yeah,
you've heard.
Exactly, yeah, and this was nothing like that. I mean, it was, you know, they sound more like a woman dying or something, you know, out there in the woods, and this thing was, I mean, it was gnarly, it really was, it's really strange.
Yeah, that's strange, especially I don't recommend shooting one near your property. But
yeah, I don't either. Yeah, I didn't. Yeah, you know, if I'd have, at the time, I kind of figured it might have been a bear or something like that. You know, whenever I told him to pull the trigger, I was assuming it was probably a bear or something. And then just right after that, I realized, hey, this is not a bear. I don't know what this is. And, I mean, it scared the hell out of my friend. I mean, you know, he was terrified.
I don't blame him.
He was in the back of the truck. He was afraid it was going to come snatch him out of the back of the truck. Now, I'm not saying it rushed the truck. But, I mean, it took three or four definite steps towards us. And the whole time continuing to rock. It was really odd.
Yeah, like it was pissed and it was coming to pay.
Yeah,
pay
it felt like it was rocking and then it stopped and then came towards us. No, this thing was, it kind of rocked four or five times and then it started moving towards us while it was rocking. It was, and I mean, when it was swaying, I would say it was probably moving a good, you know, the eyes, from what I could see, the eyes were moving back and forth a good 2 or 3 feet. I mean, this was not a gentle sway. I mean, it wasn't like an animal just shaking its head or something like that. This was definite, you know, shoulder side to side movement.
Yeah,
this wasn't
terrifying.
Like a bear. You know, you've seen a bear shake, they'll shake their head if they'll get stung by a bee or something like that. This was way too much movement for that.
Right. This was a whole body type movement.
Yeah, this was like somebody moving from the hips up. You know, rocking back and forth.
Have you talked to any of your neighbors and asked them if they've seen anything?
You know, I've talked to, got a neighbor up here that lives up on the hill away up from me, and like I said, he's since passed away, but he was 89 something years old when he passed away. And I've asked him if he'd seen anything strange, and the only thing he'd ever said he ever seen out here was timber wolves, and that was back in the 50s. But that's all they did ever say. Now, people around here are really closed mouths. Unless you really know them, have known them for years and years, you're not going to get much information out of them. You know, around here, it's a big joke, you know. Like that's the excuse you give if you're afraid to go out into the woods. It's all, you know, Bigfoot's out there, you know, and everybody will laugh.
Yeah, which is odd because, you know, Arkansas, Oklahoma, Texas, they're all over the place down there. And people are very, very, very tight-lipped when it comes to, you almost kind of have to know them. Like you said, you do have to know them or they have to feel comfortable enough with you to tell you anything. And it's funny because down there, most of those people have some of the best information.
Yeah. And see, I've told I'm big mouth. I'll tell my story just about anybody. But even me, I haven't really told it to, I'd say maybe 5 people around here. You know, that I know, and even they'll, y'all, you're crazy, you know, they don't believe me for nothing.
Yeah.
You know, besides that one friend that was, now whenever we did that, I was working with that guy that was with me whenever he shot that one, and now they believe, because, you know, he was there too, saying, hey, you know, yeah, something was definitely strange.
Yeah, no, it's a it's both of the encounters are very fascinating to me.
The very first one, I mean, it was unbelievable, because, I mean, it was just, I was, but pretty much face to face with this thing, you know. I mean, I could have easily probably reached out with a stick and touched it. I mean, I was close. And, you know, I seen him, wish I could draw or something, which I can't, but really could. I mean, I have a definite picture of this thing's face in my mind. That's what really sticks out is this thing's face to me, you know, because that's basically all I could see because of a little crappy flashlight.
When you saw the face, would you describe it more human-like, or would you say it was more apish?
You know, it was really hard to say. It was almost like you just took out a big mess. You know, it was like you mashed a human and a monkey together. You know, not really a group. I don't want to really say it was gorilla-like. I mean, the size of it was more gorilla-like than it was monkey-like, but it had more like, you know, I don't know, it just didn't have enough hair on the face, really, to be a you know, to be really gorilla-like. I mean, the skin didn't look the same as a gorilla. It was, in fact, this thing had almost tan skin. I mean, it was really light skin. So, I mean, it really stood out. That's what red, and like I said, it was almost completely gray, except for it looked like it had red streaks through it, like old river clay, not bright red, but like, you know, dull red streaks through it. And that's just really the only place I could really see it really well was from about the middle of the chest up, and it didn't have it. It didn't look like it really had a neck. Whenever it was kind of turned back looking at us, its whole front torso was turned back, looking at us. And it's kind of surprising, I think, that, you know, because we were just kids at the time. We weren't but 8 or 9 years old, maybe, you know, out there in the middle of the night with just a flashlight.
Would you say the nose was kind of like us, or was it more apish? How would you describe, like, the nose?
Yeah. Well, even the nose was kind of a cross between. It wasn't really human-like, but I don't want to say it was like, more like of its own deal. You know, it wasn't really it was wide, and it had a really wide mouth. Now, its mouth was closed, but it did have, look like, you know, apes have wrinkly lips. You know, they tend to have vertical lines on their lips.
Right.
This thing definitely had vertical lines on its lips that looked like the corner of its mouth went too far back towards its ear, you know, towards the lobe of its ear. Of course, I didn't even really see an ear on the thing, but I'm assuming that's where it would be at. But it's like, you know, its mouth was just too damn wide. So it gave it kind of an odd look.
Yeah, it reminds me of the hunter hat on. He said it, you know, he could have put a softball in the thing's mouth, and it probably
I wouldn't have doubted that a bit. Yeah, I mean, this thing was... You know, I didn't, like I said, I've never seen him open his mouth or anything, but this thing, you know, just from the you could see the corner of his mouth, and it was, you know, it was about where the end of my jaw is where the corner of this thing's mouth was at on his face. So there's no telling how big it took a bite out of something, you know.
When you're looking at the thing, did the facial expressions change at all?
Oh, whenever I was looking at it, he seemed almost like he was, I don't want to say... The only place it had any kind of a surprised look on him was in his eyes. But, you know, he did have his eyebrows or whatever were up. You know, like, hey, I got caught out here in the middle of the field. He's, you know, they're looking at him. And but other than that, that's about it almost like a surprise, but at the same time, it was almost like a not very friendly look. You know what I mean? It was, you know, surprise, but, you know, don't push me.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, you know, like I said, they're definitely their own little deal. I mean, it's hard to describe them if haven't ever seen one, because they're definitely their own deal.
Yeah, no, and I couldn't agree with you more. I think they're definitely their own creature. You know, I think a lot of people, when we describe it on the show, you know, a lot of times we'll say chimp-like or ape-like. You know, I think everyone, I'm amazed when people listen to the show, because they'll take one little tidbit out of the show and draw their own conclusions to it. But, you know, we're saying they're chimp-like or gorilla-like. You know, that's our way of describing them. Yeah.
You know, like asking someone to describe a dog, you know, if they, you know, describe it. I mean, you know, well, you know, it looks like a cat, but it's, you know, got a longer face. You know, it doesn't match. It's hard to explain something when, you know, the other person, you know, it's just, you know, it's just completely odd is what they are. Really creepy. That's what I'd put it at.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. There is something creepy about them.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like they look normal. I mean, even for, you know, they just, you know, I mean, they're definitely an animal. I mean, you can definitely tell you can tell they're intelligent, but they're, you know, I mean, I'm assuming this all from a, you know, I probably didn't get a 7 or 8 second glance at this thing 20 years ago. But, you know, that real something like that really sticks with you. You know, it's like, you know, meeting something weird out there in the middle of the woods. It really tends to stick with
you. It's amazing, too, because you can you gather so much impressions when you're in those situations, like you said.
Exactly. Yeah, you get so much impressions off of one of these things in just a glance, you know. It's incredible.
Well, and we're kind of wired to do that. Made me think of, and again, I'm not comparing it to a dog, so
yeah.
Please don't, people out there, please don't send me emails. But, you know, I used to have, I had this Labrador Retriever, Yellow Lab, and I love that dog more than anything. And when you looked at him, you could always tell he was thinking. There was just this real, and he was one of the smartest dogs I ever owned. He was very intelligent. And he always had this look on his face like he was thinking, or if you said something to him, he was really paying attention to what you're saying.
Yeah.
And then it's like, I had another lab, after he passed away at another lab. And that dog was as dumb as a rock. I mean,
just retarded. Yeah.
Yeah, you could just tell there was nothing going on upstairs.
Nothing behind the eyes, exactly.
Right. Yeah. And so I know
the eyes are the windows to the soul. For sure.
They really are. They really are.
Yeah.
And so when you're looking at this creature, you could tell it was thinking. It wasn't stupid.
Exactly. Yeah, just the whole vibe you get from just looking in this man's eyes, you know, you can tell he's thinking, you know, what's my best plan of action here? Should I kill these two or should I just continue walking into the woods? You know, I mean, there was definitely thought going on there. But at the time, I mean, even being a kid, I really wasn't too afraid, you know. Now, I wasn't real eager to chase this thing down either. But, you know, it's not like I went screaming back home. But me and him just calmly walked back towards the house after we seen this thing walk, after we finally seen him walk into the tree line down there. And we followed a little bit, and the flashlights we had were basically useless. So we decided we'd just go back home. And that was probably the best thing we could have done.
Well, do this for me, Chance. You know, keep in touch with me. Let me know if you have any more activity going on out there.
I will. Because, like I said, there has been something, you know, just here the past week or so, maybe a couple weeks, that has been definitely, you know, whistling out here on my place. Something screamed at me from a neighbor's field just right across the way. So, yeah, I definitely will.
And I can't thank you enough for coming on.
Hey, I really appreciate it, Wes. Love the show. Listen all the time.
Thanks for being here tonight, everyone. I will see you back here on Sunday. Randy Savage is my guest, and he's bringing some Sasquatch sounds with him. See you Sunday, everyone. Have a great night. Someone is a human and writer.